NIH has not ever and does not now fund gain-of-function research in the Wuhan Institute.
And then it's called the wrap-up smear. Now I'm going to merchandise the press's report on the smear that we made. And it's a tactic.
This meeting is being recorded.
Okay. Thank you all for joining today's session. It's the final of five events in the KJSNA 2022 program. Today's session was designed in the author meets critics format. And unless the author has reconsidered his surprising last minute change of heart by withdrawing his participation, we will change the format to being a book discussion. Professor Matthias Desmet is a faculty member in the Department of Psychoanalysis and Clinical Counseling at the University of Ghent in Belgium. On his webpage, he lists 132 publications in the time period starting 2005. His most recent book had been translated into English with the title The Psychology of Totalitarianism. The book has already received much attention and is heralded in some circle as a grim and accurate assessment of a contemporary political reality, where in an environment of what Desmet calls mass formation, the majority of humans allegedly surrender to a global scale manipulative rhetoric without having the cognitive capacity to recognize its presumed sinister objectives. In order to develop his narrative, Desmet heavily draws upon the work of psychologist Gustave Le Bon and on the work of the philosopher Hannah Arendt. This combination brings the Karl Jaspers Society into the conversation. Karl Jaspers himself was a practicing psychiatrist, roughly at the time when Le Bon published his book, The Crowd, in 1896. And Hannah Arendt was one of Jaspers' most successful students, who then also became an accomplished philosopher herself. Many members of the KJSNA have expertise in psychological theory and in Arendt's philosophy. Hence, KJSNA is in an excellent position to provide expert feedback on both themes that are at the heart of Desmet's argument, namely the psychology of mass formation and the philosophy of Hannah Arendt. It is not the purpose of this session to assess whether there are indeed sinister plans in the context of a great reset or similar efforts that involve the world's financial markets. Instead, the purpose of the panel is to engage in a collegial academic discourse as to whether some arguments presented in Professor Desmet's books, namely those that involve psychological theory in general, and Hannah Arendt's philosophy in particular, are convincingly substantiated. I'm grateful to each and every one of the commentators who have remained committed to this task, despite the unexpected withdrawal by Professor Desmet, who so far was not even inclined to read these reviews, let alone discuss them publicly. Today's first speaker, Dr. Leela Faghouri-Azhar, is a faculty member in the Department of Jurisprudence at the University of Amsterdam in the Netherlands. Her expertise includes critical legal theory, human rights theory, and international and European law. She has conducted extensive research on Hannah Arendt, including Arendt's essay, The Rights of Man, What Are They?, that was published shortly after the 1948 adoption of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Arendt's essay was republished as chapter 9 in her book, The Origins of Totalitarianism, the book that is central to Desmet's argument. It's my great pleasure to welcome Dr. Faghouri-Azhar. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Helmut. Please let me first thank Heart Diaspora Society of North America for organizing this event, and particularly my thanks to you for inviting me to speak in this book discussion session. Also thanks for the introduction. Well, just very briefly to say, I would like to emphasize that I'm here to present my thoughts on Desmet's book, particularly from my own perspective, which is a critical, legal, theoretical perspective, I would put it that way. And the role of Hannah Arendt's philosophy in my work, in my research, and in my teaching as a great source of inspiration obviously have been the one to help me understand structures of violence and domination. And I have actually adopted this perspective once I started reading Desmet's book and also developing some reflections on his book. Well, in order to have a more focused presentation, I prefer to read from the short paper that I have prepared for today. Matthias Desmet's Psychology of Totalitarianism presents an engaging analysis of the process of mass formation, which, according to him, is the psychological basis of totalitarianism. As he discusses, central to this process is the creation of a particular form of human subject whose presence and functioning in the society is conditioned on a continuous existential state of fear and anxiety, an ever-present element in totality of her everyday life. The constant presence of anxiety in the living condition of the subject of totalitarianism is produced by a dominant ideology that justifies the rationale and enforces mechanisms of othering and domination in every sphere of social life. Desmet's examination of the role of science as the ideology of modern forms of totalitarianism illustrates how narratives of success and superiority become hegemon to enable the construction of an ideal subject of totalitarianism. The central thesis of his book heavily rests on a discussion that Hannah Arendt very famously accounted for in The Origins of Totalitarianism. In a nutshell, Arendt contextualizes the emergence of totalitarianism as the third historical phase after the two phases of anti-Semitism and imperialism. On her vision of totalitarianism, the process of creating objects of fear through mechanisms of uttering, that is, according to her, anti-Semitism and expansionism for the purpose of exploitation, that is, imperialism, transforms to enforcing the ideology of fear for total domination through othering and exploitation by the totalitarian regimes of the 20th century. In other words, this is the move from othering to first expansion for exploitation and then total domination that defines the structure of totalitarianism. Desmet's book has been illuminating to make many unknown aspects of the role of ideology in the process of mass formation, the psychological basis of totalitarianism, in his words, to me. However, to me as a legal theorist who is particularly interested to investigate and learn about the interplay between agents, subjects, and structures, his book remains inattentive to the role of ideology in creation of the structures of domination. This, I believe, is an important point for further discussion because every human subject is being, to a certain extent, formed by and within social, political, and legal structures of a society where she lives. Under totalitarian regimes, such structures are being created by ideology, and therefore a more comprehensive understanding of the process of mass formation under totalitarianism requires probing the role of structures too. Let me expand this discussion further by reviewing two discussions that Desmet develops in his book. In chapter 2, Science and its Practical Application, Desmet adopts the notion of bullshit jobs to explain how the mechanisms and culture of work in modern societies detach individuals from what could help them feel important, useful, and engaged in the social and economic life. In fact, the dominant culture of bullshit jobs and its embeddedness in the structures of employment relationships in the form of growing demands of reaching targets, numbers, and statistics proliferates the experience of meaninglessness in almost every employment context. This most clearly refers to alienation, which is an essential element in the whole process of mass formation to create ideal subjects of totalitarianism. Evidently, alienation is an essential step in the process of the formation of subjects of a mass that is submissive to the totality of the dominant ideology. Needless to say, the hegemon narratives of success as earning more by not doing what is meaningful but rewarded less facilitates the internalization of the feeling or belief that it is better to earn more by doing the meaningless, according to meaningless jobs, according to Desmet, and alienating jobs, as I would prefer to call it. As Desmet observes, masses tend to follow this pattern in order not to fail to be part of the hegemon narrative or the desired mass. His observation is accurate and unravels a pivotal element of the process of mass formation. Still, the question is why totalitarian regimes attempt to expose their subjects to alienation in labor relations in order to form submissive masses. What is integral in the process of mass formation for the purpose of total domination that requires alienation in labor relations? Alienation that is embedded in the labor relations of bullshit jobs appears to be a smart escape from improper rewarding or low remuneration or payment. Low remuneration or payment could be quickly linked to exploitation, and exploitation would essentially refer to taking advantage of one's labor in the form of no or low payment for the purpose of accumulation of capital, money, and wealth by the exploiter. Here, one could ask whether the culture of bullshit jobs protects subjects of modern totalitarianism against exploitation or not. In fact, one could question the structural function of the dominance of this culture and the alienation embedded in it. I would reflect on this question by highlighting the element of internalization of alienation as an immediate consequence of such hegemon culture in the social and legal structures of labor relations, which aims at creating organized forms of exploitation. Due to the modern totalitarian regime's smart and advanced strategies to govern social relations, most importantly, relations of production, mechanisms of exploitation and domination through alienation are created by enforcement of hegemon cultures of work, but not classic bare mechanisms of, for example, enslavement and forced or compulsory labor. It must be noted that alienation has been always the very first and thus most crucial step in commodification of labor and laborer for the purpose of exploitation. Given that, the next question would address the role of exploitation, or to put it in more accurate words, structures of exploitation in the process of mass formation under totalitarian regimes. In chapter 7, The Leaders of the Masses, Desmet argues that this is a misconception that leaders of totalitarian regimes are driven by money. This, according to him, is due to the fact that these leaders firmly believe in the ideological basis of the narratives they have made to govern the masses. In my opinion, this argument precludes an essential element of the foundations of totalitarian regimes, which is the creation of structures of exploitation for the purpose of acquiring money and capital that is crucial to sustain the dominance of the hegemon narrative and ideology. Here, I do not tend to base my discussion on the role of individual leaders themselves, though one must note that in every political system, particularly in totalitarian regimes, leaders symbolize the structure of power. I would rather like to focus on the structural attempts of the leadership institutions to accumulate money and capital under totalitarian regimes, which could take place in varying forms, for example, you know, confiscation and forced labor to what we could call enforcing internalized alienation to submit to the culture of bullshit jobs. If money in Desmet's words, or accumulation of capital, as I would like to call it, does not drive the leadership of totalitarianism to impose and reimpose the dominant narratives of, for example, anti-Semitism under Nazi Germany, or purging society of enemies of people under Stalin's regime, how could we explain the plunder of Jews, the organized and systematic dispossession of Jewish people, seizure of their assets and belongings before transferring them to labor and then extermination camps, all of them under Nazi Germany? How could we place these practices under the logic of totalitarianism and the process of mass formation? I would like to sum up by highlighting that this cannot be a coincidence that totalitarian regimes created and still create the most exploitative structures as apparatus of domination and profit making. If not individual leaders themselves, the institution of totalitarian leadership is both driven by and dependent on money and capital accumulation to maintain its power for the purpose of total control and total domination of masses. History shows us these structures were functional in labor and extermination camps. The emergence of the phenomenon of state capitalism under both Nazi Germany and Soviet Union testifies to this. But as we can witness today, these structures are also functional within free societies, which are dominated by the culture of bullshit jobs. Isn't it interesting that bullshit job holders who have internalized a constant sense of alienation in their everyday life and work produce more profit and the biggest financial benefits for their employers, companies, enterprises, and states, those who own means of production and govern the social relations of labor, the capitalists? Back to Arendt's vision on totalitarianism, it must be reiterated that the move from creating an object of fear to total domination of masses would become possible through creating structures of alienation and exploitation. In this line, I would like to put this question, which has occupied my mind already for many years, to the fore for further discussions with my colleagues in the panel and also the audience. And my question is, under the economic and political leadership of tech giants, how could we better understand the logic and structures of domination behind the process of mass formation in a world where social media users, which is, you know, the population of approximately 4 billion people, have deliberately accepted, signed up to produce data, which is allegedly the most valuable capital of our time in their everyday lives? In other words, my question is the ideal subject of modern totalitarianism subjugated to the dominant ideology and the hegemon narratives based on it alone, or is he also subjugated to exploitation to produce benefit for the institution of totalitarian leadership?
Thank you, Lila. Let's open the floor for the discussion. Maybe perhaps first the panelists.
Thank you very much, Leila. I was not sure, so this is my question, twofold question. The first part is whether you do agree with Desmet on with the Desmet diagnosis that we live in a period of a new totalitarianism. I mean, do you find it pertinent to speak in terms of totalitarianism from for today? And the second thing, it's not exactly a question. I'm a bit reluctant toward your claim that totalitarianism is, I mean, the classic, the two versions, Nazism and Stalinism, that you can totally understand them, at least from an Arendian point of view, in terms of accumulation of capital, of money capital. I prefer the expression capital rather than the expression accumulation of money. But I think that it, at least from Arendt's point of view, I think that this is not at all the case. And because she sees, as you know, totalitarianism as something that is, whose logic is anti-utilitarian, and so there is this limit for understanding. But also it's not the case for Arendt. I mean, it's the case for even interpreters or people who have analyzed totalitarian Stalinism, Stalinist totalitarianism, for example, Claude Lefort or Cornelius Castoriadis, who also, you know, they were not content with such approaches in terms of, well, two Marxist approaches, let me say, quickly. But thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you very much, Vicky, for two very nicely formulated and important questions. You know, very brief answer to the first question. I agree with Desmet to a certain extent that we live in the era of modern totalitarianism, let me put it this way, but I do not particularly agree with the way that he describes, you know, the process of formation of masses under totalitarianism. But because I particularly see the role of structures, political and legal structures, very much important in creation of the whole environment of totalitarianism. And in this presentation, I tried actually to emphasize on this point. So this is a very quick answer to the first question. But with regards to the second point, yes, I see your point, not from a traditional perspective on totalitarianism. It's not so accurate to talk about the role of money accumulation as an element in the creation of totalitarianism as a political structure or a political regime. But, you know, as I was read in your commentary, so the way that Arendt has been received by thinkers such as Claude Lefort and the way that she has been criticized says that the creation of state capitalism is also something that goes hand in hand with having totalitarian regimes in place. And this is exactly what I'm trying to stress on here in this presentation. And I would like actually to think about it and also receive your insights on this question, that how is it possible to think about creation of totalitarian regimes without investigating the role of structures of alienation and exploitation, which are necessary to form totalitarian control or total domination over people, over mass population. This is my point, and I hope it has clarified things.
Alienation is a many layers, has many layers of the meaning. There is an economic aspect of alienation, social element of alienation, and psychological. They are very different. When you talk about alienation, which of the aspects of its meaning you mean? Also, alienation is a common phenomenon in European countries. And how come only Germany came out with the totalitarian political regime? Negation of alienation might have different forms, not necessarily totalitarian. In what I read about the book and your presentation, but you didn't really touch on this. People alienated, workers, look like they are willingly and joyfully welcome totalitarian political regime, which provide for them not only basic needs to survive economic, but social status and the purpose in life. So, but the reality, and the reality which I know from firsthand because I was born in the Soviet Union. So is such that it's not, the people never took it willingly and joyfully. So they are submitted to the reality of political totalitarian regime because of the fear. Fear of repression from this regime. And the regime doesn't exist, the totalitarian regime, without the means of terror and repression. And this is what makes the totalitarian structures totally unique. The fear, the terror, and you know, like the means how it works in different countries have different mechanisms, but the close connection between the administrative power, the state power, party, political power, party power, the army and police, it's the same power. And that makes it the whole terrorist regime, the machine work. Well, that's my point.
Thank you very much, Lida. Just a quick answer to the first question that you asked. So the particular conception of alienation that I have in my mind and tried actually to incorporate in my presentation is that form of alienation, which is being experienced in the labor context, labor relations, employment context. And then in that sense, it is different from alienation on a psychological level. Let me put it that way. And I totally understand what you say, and that is absolutely correct, that under, you know, classic totalitarian regimes, that experience of alienation takes place because people find themselves constantly under the sense of fear because of experiencing control, which is imposed by state with different apparatus and mechanisms that it has everywhere, in every place. That I accept. But well, back to Desmet's book, you know, I find his observation in chapter 2 interesting, that it appears that under that culture of bullshit job, as he puts it, people appear to accept to work, which in a sense are actually the form of labor relations in which they are exposed to alienation. But it appears that they have accepted it. But the point is that, well, in chapter 7, he says that, you know, it is not correct to think about leaders of totalitarian regimes as those who want to accumulate money by enforcing a narrative culture which is based on the ideology that dominates the society and masses. And there I disagree with him. You know, the mechanisms of alienation, as I see it in our life, I mean, in today's life, is different from what that was experienced, for example, in Soviet Union. You know, so it appears that we or people accept to internalize a sense of alienation in order to be part of the mass. However, they perhaps are not aware or do not want to accept that by accepting that alienation, they are contributing to the process of money accumulation, capital accumulation by the leadership institution. This is what I try to highlight in this presentation. And I hope it somehow clarifies the point that were actually puzzling to you.
Yeah, but it's still, for me, it's not unclear psychological mechanism, because the book is called Psychology of Totalitarianism. You gave the analysis of rather from the economic point of view, not psychological.
Yeah, particularly because I'm not a psychologist, I'm a legal theorist, and I made it clear from the very beginning that I am here to reflect on the way that Arendt has been incorporated in Desmet's book and from my point of view, and based on my experience in which I actually used Arendt to understand legal and political structures of domination and violence, I see the role of understanding and covering structures of exploitation which are necessary to create totalitarian regimes missing in his analysis.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Lila, and thank you everyone who had contributed. The next commentary is prepared by Professor Nasir Gemi, who is the director of the Mood Disorder Program and the Psychopharmacology Consultation Clinic at Tufts Medical Center. He's also professor of psychology and pharmacology and attending psychiatrist at Tufts University School of Medicine. Further, he lectures on psychiatry at Harvard Medical School. He received the 2020 Prose Award from the Association of the American Publishers for Excellence in Biological and Life Sciences. His expertise includes Carl Jaspers's work on psychopathology and Jaspers's subsequent philosophical output, including Hannah Arendt. Furthermore, he has published over 100 scientific articles and has written or edited 8 books on mental health, clinical psychopharmacology, psychiatry, and statistics. And this familiarity with statistics provides an additional angle by which to assess the statistical claims presented in Desmet's book.
Thank you, Helmut. I've written my review, and I'm going to give my discussion in 3 basic parts. The first is a critique of science. So the second relates to the social psychology of mass behavior. And the third is the psychology of, relates to the concept of totalitarianism per se. And as you described, I'm a psychiatrist and some of our colleagues here are psychiatrists, psychologists. So we can certainly speak to the psychology of this. I also have training in philosophy, so I'm just going to speak to some of the conceptual backgrounds. First, on the critique of science, the first part of this book, the author is a psychologist. He also has some statistical background, so you would think he would know more about what he discusses. Perhaps he does more than he does know more than he writes, but what he's written is not only not erudite, but it's very simplistically false. Now, let me describe these issues. Basically, among the things that he discusses, he says that science is essentially mechanistically materialistic. Everything he describes about science would be true if the world had suddenly exploded in 1900, and all that we knew about science was the science of the 19th century. Everything he critiques about science has already been done for 100 years and relates to the scientific positivism of the 19th century, which was a simplistic, mechanistic, materialistic perspective. But scientific realism, as some people call it, or science in a non-positivistic sense, has been developed for 100 years in the thinking of philosophers of science like Karl Popper, Charles Peirce, William James, Thomas Kuhn, of course, many others, not to mention scientists themselves, has really evolved a great deal from the claims. The author is critiquing people who died 100 years ago in terms of what he thinks science is like. Obviously, he doesn't know what science is, although he has published some in psychology. Nonetheless, you don't see it come through. For instance, he cites scientific fraud as a reason as to reject science. This would be like saying there's fraud in business, so we should never go into a store and buy anything. Of course, there's fraud in everything. There's fraud in psychology. Maybe we shouldn't listen to psychologists. So that means nothing. He cites this one study that 85%, the title of the study is Why Most Published Research is False, and the number 85% is cited. He never discusses the content of the study, of the review, but repeatedly cites it. It may be that he didn't read the paper. Or maybe he just read the abstract, as many people do. Or maybe he didn't understand it. Or maybe worse, he understood it and he doesn't want to tell it in the book what the review said because it contradicts all of his ideas. This is a paper by John Yiannatis, a Greek-American physician who used to be on the Tufts faculty, who I knew personally. And I've read the review carefully and I've talked with him about it. I've cited it myself many times in my papers. What the 85% number comes from is basically the concept of evidence-based medicine, to put it briefly to you, just to show you how false the author is. The concept of evidence-based medicine is that because there are confounding factors in the real world, various factors that influence a result, you can't just do observational studies and report your observations and draw cause and effect conclusions. For instance, coffee drinking is associated with cancer. It's been shown many times in observational studies. But that's because in the past, at least, coffee drinkers tended to be cigarette smokers. And it was the cigarette smoking, of course, that caused the cancer. The coffee drinking was not causal. It was an association. The confounding factor was cigarette smoking. This is a constant issue in medicine and psychiatry. We teach it all the time. So if you do observational studies, the majority of the causal connections are actually false because they're being influenced by these confounding factors. That's where the 85% number comes from. That's a mathematical model of how frequently you would get false findings by doing observational studies. The solution in science for the last 50 years has been to do randomized studies. When you randomize patients to get a treatment or not, all the confounding factors are equalized and they cancel each other out. If none of this makes any sense to you or you've never heard about it before, then you should just throw this book away because it doesn't explain it to you and you don't know enough about science to interpret it. But you can't simply say 85% of findings are false. So in randomized studies, 85% of the findings are true. Actually, 90% or so are true, depending on how large the study is. And the paper actually says that. The paper says that when you restrict yourself to randomized data, you start getting about 80 to 90% truth. When you don't have randomized data, it's 89% falsehood. So these vaccine studies are huge randomized trials. Based on Yiannatis' analysis, they're 90% likely to be true, not 90% likely to be false. So this is an example of the pseudoscience that our author is using in his critique of science. There's more. It's in my paper. I'm not going to give you more details. You can read it. Couple points I'll make, though. For instance, the idea that science ignores the subjective. This is a general critique of 19th century mechanistic positivistic science. But there's plenty of 20th century science that includes the subjective. My friend Michael Schwartz, who is a Jaspers expert and knows very well, as I do, that there's this whole tradition in psychiatry of psychopathology research that actually looks at subjective experiences. So that's not true. Some claims about COVID are just obviously false. He claims that on a newspaper article in Belgium that hospitals actually hospitalized COVID patients to make more money. Doesn't provide any of the data. Here in the US, in my hospital at Tufts, we've had to lay off many staff. And the hospital has clearly gone into a loss of money ever since the pandemic started, because the elective surgeries and the elective procedures were all canceled. Those were the things that made them the money, not COVID. So another example of a false claim, and this is supposedly part of his critique of science. Another critique that he gets into in some detail is the issue of measurability. This is a longstanding critique of science, the idea that maybe you can't measure things accurately, or maybe what you're measuring is external and not really the real problem objectively, subjectively. Well, the whole field of statistics has come into existence for the last couple hundred years to deal with this reality that when you measure something, you're not getting 100% accurate measurement. There's some uncertainty. And that's why we have a range of statistical methods to reduce this uncertainty, and not just in measurability, but even in plain validity. And that's the whole concept of randomization that I brought up. He doesn't discuss this at all. He doesn't even refer to it. He just claims, well, there's some uncertainty of measurability. He cites, you know, the high school level knowledge of physics, which is the uncertainty principle of the quantum physicists, is to say that that's nothing. You really can't know anything. Whereas we have really a very indeed erudite and complex field of statistics that helps reduce uncertainty to a point where you can feel very confident in some results. Not that it's ever zero, that's true, but it's very, very, very unlikely that some of these statistically appropriately analyzed and conducted studies are false. A couple examples I would give is if you really believe that science is completely false or mostly false, well, you have three examples that I'd like to find out whether a person who believes that lives it. And this is what I would ask this of the author. I would also ask this of any of you who may be sympathetic to the author. Have you ever taken antibiotics for anything? Did you ever take an antibiotic for an infection of any kind? Because if you did, then science is not false. And if you believe science is false, you should never take a penicillin or anything. You know, before the antibiotic era in the 1930s, there are some wonderful books on medicine written by people in the mid 20th century that review what life was like before and after antibiotics in the 1940s. One of my favorites is Lewis Thomas, who was a great physician writer. And in The Youngest Science, which is a collection of his essays, he writes about how when he was an intern in the 1930s in Boston, a young boy came to the emergency room with a finger that was cut. The finger got infected and caused sepsis, and the boy died. Children would die of a cut finger in the 1930s and earlier. But when penicillin came along, all of them were cured. So I would like to ask the author never to take penicillin, never to give it to any of his children or family members. And let's see how science is fraudulent and how long he survives. The second example is cigarette smoking. If science is fraudulent, the author should smoke cigarettes, and I would recommend 5 packs a day for about 20 years. And let's see if he gets lung cancer or not, if science is fraudulent. You know, cigarette smoking's association with lung cancer was never proven in a randomized trial, because you can't randomize people to that kind of outcome. It's an observational study, actually. Many observational studies, I suppose it's 85% likely to be false. In that case, though, really, the author should smoke cigarettes. Maybe he does. Maybe he's a chain smoker. The third thing he should do, if he really thinks science is false, is just go to the nearest 20-floor building and jump off the building. He should jump off the building if he thinks science is false, because the law of gravity isn't true then. That's part of science. We can't believe science, can we? So smoke cigarettes, don't take antibiotics, and jump off the nearest building if you really believe science is false. Now I'm going to the second topic, which is social psychology. Here he cites Gustave Le Bon, a physician writer of the late 1800s, who has had a lot of influence in the field of social psychology of mass behavior. He was cited by Freud, who really popularized him. But Le Bon's writings, if you read about him, he was a bestseller when he wrote his book. That was a bestseller. That's why it's had so much influence. But he was a polymath. He was actually very much into physics, for instance. He never actually practiced medicine, though he studied it. He was a writer. He was not a practicing scientist. And if you read his works, The Crowd is his most famous work, there's not a single reference there, not a single citation. There's not a single scientific study. There's not any empirical observation. It's not based on scientific data at all. If you believe in science, and I hope we've already established you should believe in science, there's no scientific basis. It's just his opinions. And the author here cites Le Bon's opinions as if they're true, as if they're just well known to be true or proven true. Well, we've had 100 years of social psychology since then, social psychology research, and the author doesn't cite any of it. I've listed a few people he doesn't cite, but one person I've read about since I wrote my review, as I looked into this some more, is Stephen Rector, R-E-C-H-T-E-R, who is a social psychology professor in Scotland, who is an expert in crowds and mass behavior. He's written about this. And the author made no effort, apparently, to even just go into Google Scholar, type in social psychology, mass behavior, and see what's been published in the last 100 years. He only cites a late 1800 French writer, and that's it. Rector, for instance, in his work, they critique the Le Bon idea. The Le Bon thesis, as you all know from reading it, just to summarize it briefly, is that in masses, people basically lose their individual identities and their conscious decision-making, and they become one big mass unconscious that behaves impulsively and erratically. That's to summarize it. This perspective, having seeped into the culture, Rector describes how it's had negative effects. For instance, when police repress protests, such as in the Black Lives Movement, that's based on the assumption that the masses are unconscious, impulsive, dangerous, and violent, just like Le Bon said, and just like our author repeats. This belief system is actually an excuse for totalitarian repression. Not the cause of totalitarianism, but an excuse for it. But beyond that, what Rector writes is that when you do some research on this topic, what you find, he says, is that masses or crowds are not these jumbles of unconscious groups without any identity. In fact, in the social psychology literature, there's this discussion of social identity. that you go from a personal individual identity to a social identity. So Hitler's crowds, when they got together in those huge rallies, were developing a social identity around being Nazis. And then when they left the rally and they went home to their individual lives, they could feel they were Nazis because in those rallies, they had this social cohesion with other people who had the same view. It's not that they were unconscious and anonymous. Actually, they consciously developed a new social identity. And Rector talks about how Donald Trump has been doing the same thing with his rallies. So the fascism totalitarianism comes not from an amorphous mass, but actually from a consciously organized new social identity of these masses that totalitarians create. And our author, who supports some of these people and claims he's describing that their opponents are totalitarian, doesn't seem to realize this, partly because he never seemed to type into Google Scholar the word social psychology and research to look at anything that's been done in the last 100 years. My third point is on totalitarianism and the psychology of totalitarianism, but also the concepts behind it. This relates to the science critique. Now, my general point is that the author's basic ideology is a postmodernist extremism. Let me explain this. Postmodernism, as you may know, one interpretation of it is the rejection of the Enlightenment era, the pre-1900 era of belief in reason and progress and science. The idea of the Enlightenment era was that, well, we can put religion behind and our basis of belief in religion as the source of truth, and we can replace it with reason and science. And that led to a lot of the industrial developments of the 19th century. And this was critiqued by Nietzsche, most famously, but in isolation until World War I, and then World War II, and then the genocides of World War II, all of which proved to many people that indeed the European Western Enlightenment tradition, a belief that peace and prosperity would follow the acceptance of reason and science and democracy, was false. It was proven false. In the core of the cultural capital of the Western world, which was Germany. Now, Heidegger and Karl Jaspers in the 1920s in Germany realized this, and on their reading of Nietzsche and their experience of World War I, and later really created this new way of thinking, which many of you are experts at. The difference between the two was that Heidegger took an anti-science attitude. He believed that science was just another form of power. If you take Nietzsche's view that knowledge is power, that doesn't mean that knowledge gives you power. It means the power allows you to impose your knowledge on other people. As you all know, many of you accept this kind of view, this concept of discourses. And science is just another form of discourse, as Foucault would later say. It's not any better than religion. It's not any better than anything. And that's what this author's underlying belief system is. Jaspers, on the other hand, being a physician and a psychiatrist, realized that science has limits, but that doesn't mean it's no better than anything else. Within its limits, it's quite good. It's quite meaningful. Within its limits, it's correct. It's true. It's not valid to say it's just as untrue as anything else. That's a postmodernist relativism. That's an extreme perspective that unfortunately has become very popular in our culture in the last 100 years, because after World War II, Heidegger became the hero of Foucault. And as the author in this text frequently quotes Heidegger and says that totalitarianism grows out of the Enlightenment tradition, this is the Heidegger view, the Foucault view, the view this author takes. Whereas in fact, Jaspers' view was totalitarianism was a rejection of the Enlightenment tradition. And that was Hannah Arendt's view, who was a close disciple of Jaspers. So the author is completely wrong in his attempt to use Arendt to defend his view of totalitarianism. Arendt had the exact opposite view, following Jaspers. Totalitarianism comes about when you become a postmodernist, relativist extremist, when you reject all truths. Anything is possible, nothing is forbidden. When that's the case, you can lie repeatedly, as Hitler did, and create a department of propaganda. And that's how you create a totalitarian psychology, not just the power structures in society that had existed before, but the totalitarian psychology. That's what Stalin did too, with the purges and so on. And that's what the anti-COVID totalitarians do. They lie repeatedly, and it's proven that they lie, but their followers believe them as part of the social identity that they now have created in this mass psychology of totalitarianism. That's my interpretation of it. That's Jasper's interpretation of it. That's Arendt's interpretation of it. And by the way, that's the interpretation of other people like George Orwell, who very clearly argued that the Stalinist and Nazi totalitarianism came about because of a relativism about truth. That's the conceptual core. That's the rejection of the Enlightenment, this postmodernist relativism about truth, which in our culture became the mainstream after the counterculture of the 1960s, which was this postmodernist perspective entering the culture. Then the culture wars of the 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s. Now this postmodernist relativism is not the counterculture, it's the mainstream culture of the West. And that's why people like this author, very unconsciously apparently, are able to make this clearly postmodernist extremist critique of science and of totalitarianism and actually say things that are the complete opposite of the truth, such as Arendt's view of totalitarianism, and not realize it otherwise. I think, in fact, that the debates we're having these days around COVID have to do with this postmodernist spirit of the age, which is not all bad. It's true in the sense that, yes, science has limits and so on. But when you take it to an extreme, then you create a lot of real world harm, as we're seeing. And this concept of totalitarianism is, it's funny because it's so false that it's being claimed against the public health measures. Whereas in reality, the totalitarianism comes from the people who reject science, who reject the Enlightenment tradition. And in history, they are the ones who were the totalitarianisms. They were the Nazis and the Soviets, not in the Enlightenment era people. And to finalize this as a proof, you know, Heidegger collaborated with the Nazis. They are, so if you become a postmodern relativist, you will become prone to totalitarianism. And Jaspers was the most prominent opponent to the Nazis among German intellectuals. And he was in favor of the Enlightenment tradition. That contradicts the claims in this book in real world.
Nasir, good to see you. I just want to say I really appreciate your comments. You know, I'm also a psychologist, and I have all these various associations to what Desmond says in his book, but he's certainly not convincing to me in terms of his rant against science and your kind of incisive critique is really much appreciated.
Nasir, I'd like to just, again, reinforce what you're saying from my own specialty, which is in economics. We've got issues in economics for sure in terms of its ability to truthfully analyze the phenomena that we deal. But the answer is not to throw overboard the statistical understanding of what we observe. It's to use those tools to bring us to the threshold of making sound judgments. I like to say to my students that the last number of recessions have occurred not because financiers didn't know how to do math, but they didn't know how to understand the consequences of the decisions that they made. And I think that that's our challenge always in working with the world, to use the tools that are at our disposal in skillful but humble ways, and then use that to set the stage for making good judgments, something that I believe that both Arendt and Jaspers argued in favor of for their entire careers.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Hugh. And I think that's a reflection of modern science as opposed to 19th century science. Modern science is very humble. It is very aware of its limits. And the author here will cite some of the the very public discussions of our limits, such as Yiannatis's nice paper, to claim, see, science is all false. In 19th century science, there was much more grandiosity, much more, I think, arrogance. But we are much more humble, which I think makes us stronger. This is what Jaspers used to say. He said that the knowledge of your of limitations is what makes a method powerful.
I like to, not just with my students, but with my peers, remind myself that humility is a fact-based virtue. Yes.
Well, but I'd like to comment a little bit. But, you know, the totalitarian ideology, it is ideology. They claim to be both, you know, National Socialist and Stalinist Soviet ideology. They claim to be most truthful, most scientific.
That's right.
And this is what they sell. Right. And this is what people react to. You see, it's and in this sense that the totalitarian ideology is not the direct mind, you know, it's a perverse right. mind.
Yeah, of course. So when you are selling a big lie, you don't say, I'm lying to you, believe me. You say a lie. And there's two possibilities. One is, as the leader, you either believe the lie yourself, in which case you've engaged in self-deception, or you know it's untrue and you're just fooling people. In the case of Stalin, for instance, in the purges, he in the 1930s, he got all these people like Bukharin and all these other guys to go admit, to confess to being traitors to socialism and communism, when in fact they weren't. So he got people to lie, and then that's how he sold it. Now, presumably Stalin knew that these people were not actually traitors to socialism. So in that case, Stalin was lying to the people on this totalitarian ideology. On the other hand, Hitler really did believe in what he was doing. And there was a self-deception there. And Jaspers talks about life-sustaining lies. And he has these letters, as Michael Schwartz mentioned, extensive correspondence with Hannah Arendt, very useful reading. After her trip to Jerusalem, he said, you're going to get into a lot of trouble with the Jewish community because we don't want to believe that these Nazis weren't just evil people, that in fact, they're just regular people who bought into a false ideology. And that's because they have we have this life-sustaining lie, he said, that we deceive ourselves to believe otherwise. It's true that the Nazis were selling themselves as a science. They called it a German science.
Yeah,
and I have this book here, The Nazi Doctors by Robert J. Lifton, which showed how the medical establishment went along with them. They were lied to, and they believed the lies. That's what totalitarianism is. It's not being lied to and knowing that you're being lied to. The author of this book is deceiving himself. He believes his own lies. He's been lied to by Foucault, who was lied to by Heidegger. And these guys are all lying to each other, and they're lying all in this world of postmodernist ideology. Not to say that everyone else is true. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, like Jasper said, you need to be self-critical. And by the way, one more big picture point I forgot to make. The concept mass formation has never existed in human history. You will not find it anywhere in Gustave Le Bon's writings. You will not find it anywhere, as far as I can tell, in any social psychology writing. You will not find it anywhere in any of the psychiatric literature for the last 200 years. The term mass formation is completely made up by this person and his friend who goes on a Joe Rogan podcast and talks about it to a couple million people, to the point of Layla's point about the harms of social media. Obviously, we know that's a good way to lie very easily these days. But this concept of mass formation has no scientific basis, no conceptual basis that anyone else has ever written about, no theoretical basis that anyone else has written about. People have talked about mass psychosis, mass hysteria. But again, these are just metaphors. They're actually, no, there's no scientific basis to it. That's a larger topic. We can talk about what people have written about. For instance, there's a large psychoanalytic literature on the authoritarian personality. My friend Oliver is here. He mentioned it to me. There's a literature on various aspects of trying to understand the psychology of following a despotic leader. But this concept of mass formation, I just want to make that point. And he doesn't point this out at all in the book, has no basis in anybody else's thinking.
Yeah, I wanted to make a comment. One of the real disappointing things about the book was the heightened polarization. Once again, we can't say, well, there's some truth in the middle. There's a little bit here and a little bit there. There's propaganda. You're horrible. You're monsters. And I know the truth. This book is certainly in that tradition, sadly. I just wanted to just make a comment. When I was a medical student, one of my most impressive teachers was this young resident named Tony Fauci.
Oh, wow.
And I'd love to talk about how I grew up because of this guy.
Wow.
Because he got involved in a case which was incredibly complicated, and he gave me the best advice. But there was a clear sense of, I don't know either. But how can you, as the head of public health, say, well, I don't know either, but we're doing our best? Remember when Fauci was talking about how we shouldn't shake hands anymore, we should bump fingers? We're doing our best, but somehow there has to be this absolute certainty, which then leads you to easily being criticized and everything you're saying being undermined. So there is a political discourse here, and I was hoping that the author would approach that more sensitively, but he unfortunately did not. The main point that I always make is we don't have smallpox anymore. Hundreds of millions of people died. There's a list of over a dozen diseases that have been badly beaten down or conquered by vaccines. And undermining faith in vaccines is terrible. And the other point that I would like to make is that public health is not truth. Guys like Fauci have their opinions. Sometimes they're right, sometimes they're wrong. But in the political climate, you can't say, well, I think that probably what we should do is this. Rules are made. So
yeah.
I find it very frustrating that how do we engage in a dialogue about this without basically saying, well, you're right and I'm wrong, or I'm right and you're wrong. What do you think about that?
Yeah, you know, I think this is a general problem, and it's especially an issue with public health. I should mention I have a master's in public health too. I've studied that as well. So this is something I've thought about long before all this. And you know, I think the problem with the public health scenario is that we start with scientific evidence that is probabilistic. Now, it may be highly probable. It's maybe 90% likely or 95, but it's never absolute, usually not. There's always pros and cons, as in all of medicine. You know, there's harms and benefits. So you're weighing all this. But as a physician, an individual physician, you can sit down with a single patient in the medical setting and discuss this back and forth. And the patient has their preferences and you have their preferences and you work it out. That's an individual thing. That's the practice of medicine. But when I went to public health school, I learned that the big difference with public health is you're no longer, by definition, you're not dealing with an individual person anymore and you can't talk to them. You're dealing with populations. And then you're dealing with policy decision making, which is being done usually by a government agency of some kind or sometimes insurance companies or whatever. And that then introduces a totally different dynamic. And I think this is what people are pushing back on. This is what people are getting upset about who disagree with the public health measures. They're focusing on the fact that it's coming from the government. And then they say, oh, this is totalitarianism. And they get into all this libertarian anti-government attitudes. Whereas in fact, that's not the real issue, but that's the problem, in fact, in terms of public health. That's an issue with public health. But it's not really the totalitarianism is not the problem. The problem is what you just brought up, that we have a knowledge base that's probabilistic, and yet we have to make a decision that's yes or no decision. And again, in medical practice, we do that all the time with each patient. But because it's an individual negotiation between the doctor and patient, that doesn't cause a larger social problem. Here, it's a larger social one. You know, I just want to add, for instance, polio doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
How are we going to, how can you defend this concept that this is all totalitarianism and you know, not pay attention to that history? And, even little things, you know, when fluoride was put in the water, There was a huge uproar about putting fluoride in the water to prevent cavities. Some people think it causes cancer. Well, not probably at the numbers amounts it's given, but that's, again, an example of pros and cons. But to your more epistemological question, Michael, which is how do we discuss this without me just saying, I'm right, you're wrong, you're right, I'm wrong. You know, in Jaspers's work, and if we want to think about him as a guide in our setting, he used the concept of a loving struggle, which was the idea that you and I can disagree, but we can disagree lovingly, or you might use the phrase, in later terminology of like Dr. King, a nonviolent disagreement. A nonviolent disagreement or a loving disagreement is one where you say, you know what, I think what I think, you think what you think, but don't kill me over it. And I'm not going to kill you over it. At least there's no violence. And don't harm me over it. Don't harm me personally. And I'm not going to harm you. Now, the part of the problem here is that the anti-COVID public health people think that they will be harmed by wearing masks or taking vaccines in a way that outweighs any real benefit that they would have. And it's hard to convince them about it rationally or scientifically because they reject in this book, the way they deal with it is by rejecting the whole concept of science so that you're not using the same rules essentially to make your decisions. But I think maybe the beginning of it is Jaspers' concept of a loving struggle, King's perspective of nonviolent resistance, which means rejecting what the other person says without harming the other person. And that's easier said than done. But maybe that's one way to look at it.
Well, I agree. I would highly recommend that we all reread or read for the first time or have people read a correspondence between Jaspers and Hannah Arendt, which went on from the 1920s to Jaspers' death in 1969. And that really is a loving struggle. They had very strong disagreements, and sometimes it took years for one to kind of go along with the other or vice versa, but it is about as good as we can see an example of what you're talking about.
Yeah, and I've always struggled with this issue of the loving struggle in a way too, because I was trying to understand it in a non-relativist way. Because one perspective people take is, well, you could be right, I could be right. Who knows what's true? Let's all tolerate each other's perspectives. And that's not what Jaspers was saying. He was saying, I think I'm right, and I respect that you think you're right. And now let's not just leave it at that and say, okay, it could be anything. Let's struggle. Let's communicate. You're talking about communication. I think one of the problems with this author is he's certainly struggling, but he's struggling to demolish his enemies. He's not struggling to communicate. He's not struggling to engage. I give you a personal example. I have a family friend, a young man who I've known since he was in preschool. I used to take him to preschool. He was the best friend of my child. He's become a major supporter of this anti-COVID public health and in general, that whole right-wing movement that exists in this country. And he's now in college, and I've sat down and tried to talk with him rationally about it. And I have a very positive, psychological relationship with this guy. He looks to me like a father figure. But I could not reason with him. I could not use scientific concepts beyond a certain point. And I think it gets back to Rector's concept of social identity. He's identified now with the social group that has these other views, and he can rationalize it well enough that it's very hard to communicate. This is a big problem socially for us.
In many ways, it does come down to something that Jaspers was very clear about, and that is that truth is not a possession. It is not a thing that we hold on to, but it is a dialogue. It is a process of mutual discovery. And that's part of the reason that we're humble. As part of the reason that we commit to discussion with people that we disagree with. It's not relativistic. It's an understanding that we are on a path.
So I have two points. One, I'm sympathetic to rejecting a simple-minded conception of science that's outdated. But I also think that putting forth examples such as that you have to believe in science to think that you're, when you fall off a building, you'll hurt yourself. You know, that's completely antithetical to just about what everybody has believed independently of science. So you don't, and the other examples also can be examples of correlations having to do with effects that are due to believing that the antibiotics will cure you, so that effect takes it. I'm not interested in arguing the science, because I'm sympathetic to the idea that one should not work with a simple-minded conception of science, but it works either both ways. And I just want to make a remark about Foucault and Heidegger and postmodernism. So Heidegger and Jaspers, at the time that Hannah Arendt was a student of theirs, were both deeply interested in science. And Heidegger, what most people don't realize, was deeply immersed in questions about the foundations of logic, mathematics, and physics. And he worked together with people like Oscar Becker, who was in constant communication with Hermann Weyl. My point is that it's already a gross distortion common to a lot of analytic philosophy to take Heidegger to be a simple-minded opponent of science. But when we get to Foucault and postmodernism, well, Foucault started out with a position in psychology. He never endorsed a position of absolute relativism. That he always thought of his position as in the tradition of critical theory. And from beginning to end, he cited Kant as his most important inspiration. He was not anti-rational. That's all a caricature. And when it comes to postmodernism, the people who are identified with postmodernism, such as Jean-François Lyotard, they have never held the view that contemporary fascists do, that the truth is completely fungible. Fascism likes that view because, as Hannah Arendt pointed out, fascism wants to say that all the surface truths of science and the like are fungible, in and that what matters is their truth. And that's, I think, the real danger that we face today, that all over the world, people are being told, don't trust this, don't trust that, because the deeper truth that we have is the one that matters.
The next speaker, Professor Vicky Kovu, is a faculty member at the Department of Social Anthropology at the University of the Aegean in Mytilene, Greece. Dr. Iakovou received her PhD in political science from the University of Paris Denis Diderot in 2001 with a dissertation on Hannah Arendt and critical theory. And she continued to research and publish around Arendt's political theory ever since. Her publications are in Greek language, French, and English on a variety of topics, including the Frankfurt School, contemporary political and social philosophy, Foucault, Heidegger, and Arendt. In addition, she has translated books by Ricoeur, Giddens, Zizek, Nancy, and several other distinguished philosophers. Dr. Iakovou offers unrivaled expertise on the subject matter of totalitarianism with regards to Hannah Arendt. Thank you for joining today's session.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation. The comments I had prepared were a bit longer. I have cut some passages for reasons of time, but I think I'll have to take 2 minutes more than 10. It was very difficult for me to follow Desmet's argument because for several reasons, but I'll focus on one of the reasons. It has to do with the role of Arendt's theory of totalitarianism in his book. So I'll start by some comments on Arendt first. In her essay, Understanding and Politics, The Difficulties of Understanding, Arendt says, I quote her, the choice of the new world, totalitarianism, indicates that everybody knows that something new and decisive has happened, unquote. Her resolve to use this word and to give it the full status of a concept in our political vocabulary goes hand in hand with a warning against, quote, the identification of the specific phenomenon with something familiar and rather general, unquote, and with a constant effort to challenge the all too human, again, I quote, unwillingness to admit that anything out of the ordinary has happened at all, unquote. So the concept of totalitarianism in Arendt designates a novel form of government. And since there is no form of government without institutions, Arendt lays particular emphasis on the institutions that are proper to this new regime and whose absence would mean its collapse or its alteration. So Arendt's interest in the institutional dimension of totalitarianism and of its prehistory is obvious throughout the origins of totalitarianism, but it comes at the fore most clearly in the penultimate chapter entitled Totalitarianism in Power. As you may remember, in this chapter, Arendt starts by discussing extensively the totalitarian state, which is actually a non-state, and following, among others, Franz Neumann's book, Behemoth, the Structure and Practice of National Socialism, she insists on, quote, the infinite multiplication of offices and confusion of authority, unquote, that accounts for the peculiar shapelessness or structurelessness of the totalitarian order, while also being correlated with the function of the leader. She then passes on to the secret police, the true executive branch of the government, unquote, whose methods and standards permeate the whole of totalitarian society. In this context, she focuses on the crucial role that the legal categories of the objective enemy and the possible crime play in the system. And finally, she turns to the concentration and extermination camps, which are the laboratories of the experiment of total domination. This is her famous phrase. And as such are, I quote her again, the most consequential institution of totalitarian rule, unquote. It seems to me that the concluding chapter added to the second edition, where Arendt ventures to capture the specificity of totalitarianism qua form of government by drawing from Montesquieu, makes sense only on the background of these subchapters. And let me remind that according to Montesquieu, the essence is what makes a form of government what it is, its particular structure, while the principle is what makes it move, agir in French, which he understands to be the passions that inspire human actions in each different regime. And the essence and the principle are intrinsically related and actually commenting on Montesquieu, Arendt suggests that this relationship, this interdependence between principle and essence and principle also points to, I quote her, a fundamental experience inherent in the human condition, unquote, an experience that in each regime forms the common ground of structure and action. And it's a different experience in each regime. And it is on this backdrop that Arendt develops the well-known analysis from which, in a sense, Desmet seems to draw up to a point, at least, the well-known analysis according to which terror is the essence of totalitarianism, ideology, i.e. the logicality of ideological thinking is its principle, and loneliness the corresponding basic human experience. So in the 1966 preface to the third part of The Origins, Arendt claims, quote her, we have every reason to use the word totalitarian sparingly and prudently, unquote. This is another way of stating her preference for distinctions, for which she is well known and often criticized, as you may know. This preference is also of use in another major aspect of her theory concerning the status of their origins or the prehistory of totalitarianism. In order to bring these origins to light, she turns to the septarian stream of European history in which the elements that crystallize in totalitarianism were hidden. But this turn does not imply that she sees totalitarianism as the symptom of deeper trends or as the necessary logical outcome of pre-existing ideological currents. Quite to the contrary, for Arendt, I quote, "What is unprecedented in totalitarianism is not primarily its ideological content, but the event of totalitarian domination itself," unquote. Hence her warning against, I quote her again, "the tendency to simply equate totalitarianism with its elements and origins," unquote. Such equations obscure the novelty of the regime by reducing it to the already known. They also imply that far from being the realm of contingency and unpredictability, history is the realm of necessity. So I have briefly drawn attention to Arendt's construal of totalitarianism as a political concept designating a form of government, as well as to her understanding of the prehistory of totalitarianism, because it seems to me that Desmet's approach is situated on their antipode. So let me start with the historical perspective on totalitarianism. Provided my understanding is correct, the author traces totalitarianism back to the Enlightenment. According to his analysis, at the core of the Enlightenment project is the idea that the world, humanity, and history can and should be controlled and mastered through science. Already this is quite reduces Enlightenment to the question of science, but Enlightenment is not only concerned with science, it's concerned with rights, with freedom, equality, etc. So, totalitarianism, according to Desmet, is, I quote him, "the logical conclusion of mechanistic thinking and delusional belief in the omnipotence of human rationality. As such, totalitarianism is a defining feature of the Enlightenment tradition," unquote. So whereas Arendt undertakes a nuanced investigation of the multiple elements whose crystallization into totalitarianism was contingently brought about by totalitarian movements, Desmet seems to opt for a linear and monocausal explanation according to which the Enlightenment scientific worldview is responsible for the totalitarian regimes of the 20th century, as well as for the technocratic totalitarianism of our times. What is more, there are instances where Desmet's narrative comes near to implying that ideas and worldviews have an agency of their own. According to Desmet, I quote him again, "mass formation and totalitarianism are in fact symptoms of the mechanistic ideology." And although this claim goes counter to Arendt's approach, the author finds in Arendt an ally. After raising the claim that she sees totalitarianism as, I quote, "the logical extension of a generalized obsession with science, the belief in an artificially created paradise," unquote, Desmet quotes the following passage from The Origins. I read again, "Science has become an idol that will magically cure the evils of existence and transform the nature of man." But actually, this is a phrase found in Eric Fergling. We see this in the notes, in Desmet's notes. But if we go to The Origins of Totalitarianism and we read the two paragraphs where Arendt discusses, where we find this phrase by Fergling and Arendt discusses this position, we realize that Arendt does not agree with Fergling. So Desmet here attributes to Arendt a claim by Fergling with which Arendt disagrees. So let me now pass on to the question of totalitarianism as a political concept. In the introduction, Desmet states that he will not, quote, "focus on that which is usually associated with totalitarianism, concentration camps, indoctrination, propaganda, but rather on the broader cultural historical processes from which totalitarianism emerges." This is, unquote, "this is a legitimate approach on the condition that one explicates how one construes totalitarianism." And here is one of the few explicit formulations in this respect that I found in the book. Totalitarianism, it's on page 7, is extreme government control, eventually resulting in radical destruction of both the psychological and the physical integrity of human beings, unquote. Also, the author maintains, as you may know, that he has in mind, and as I've said before, a new kind of totalitarianism that he calls technocratic. And his diagnosis is that we live in a period of transition from democracy to a totalitarian technocracy in which the coronavirus crisis was a great leap forward. And among the signs that he enumerates as proof of this are the following. I quote some of them for reasons of time: intrusive actions by security agencies, the general advance of surveillance society, the increased pressure on the right to privacy, loss of support for democratic principles, and the introduction of an experimental vaccination program and QR code as condition for having access to public spaces. I'll not discuss the coronavirus issue, but I'd just like to underscore that all the other signs belong to the repertoire of practices of dictatorial or authoritarian regimes. The author does not develop arguments that would substantiate the claim that these are indications of a new version of totalitarianism. Several related questions, equally crucial, I think, both in theoretical and in practical terms, also remain unanswered. Questions such as the following, which is the specificity of this new version of totalitarianism? What distinguishes this version from and what relates it to the classic totalitarian regime that Arendt analyzed? Which are the institutions and political forces, movements, parties, etc., that are the bearers of this new version of totalitarianism? And what about institutions and forces that defy these signs? Have they all disappeared? So the discussion of mass formation, I think it's insufficient as an answer, and there are other problems that were mentioned before. At some points, in my view, Desmet's allusion to the masses implying an elitism that I believe is foreign to the spirit, if not to the letter of Arendt's work, even obscures things instead of clarifying them. So it seems to me that from Desmet's angle, totalitarianism is not at all viewed as a form of government, but rather as a diffuse societal climate and a psychological setup. And in some cases, he gives the impression of reading Arendt as if her contribution were also a theory principally based upon a psychological approach, which is not the case for Arendt. For example, he claims that in The Origins, Arendt situates the essence of the difference between totalitarianism and dictatorial forms of government at a psychological level, page 90. So to recapitulate, I would say that the major flaw of the book consists in the fact that the author's proper understanding of totalitarianism remains unclear, moving between an over-thematized psychological level and an under-thematized political level, while Arendt is Desmet's primary, if not unique, reference in the field of political theory, he simultaneously distances himself from core dimensions of her understanding of totalitarianism. In contradistinction to Arendt, Desmet pays scant attention to the institutional aspects of totalitarianism in its classic or its new version, thus voiding the concept of its political content. The term does not designate a form of government, but rather an unspecified psychological societal condition. And so little space is left for Arendt's cautions against hasty equations and or generalizations, as well as for what she tried to capture when discussing the essence, the principle, and the fundamental experience of this form of government. I'm not defending some kind of Arendtian purism, but an author has, of course, the right to draw inspiration from other authors, but it is essential to state where the inspiration begins and where it ends. Desmet should have been more accurate on this in this respect, and if he had rendered explicit the points on which his approach differs from Arendt's, the argument of the book would have been easier for me to follow, but my disagreement with his diagnosis would have persisted. Thank you.
Just say that I appreciate your remarks. I'm not an Arendt scholar, but it just seemed that the author's treatment of her was, I would say, superficial, you know. And I returned to Arendt after reading the book because I just find there a kind of nuance and sort of intellectual rigor that that I did not find in the book itself.
Yes, he's I think he's too quick with everything, among others with Arendt. And also there are several, I mean, even this, the question of the Enlightenment and science, etc., there is a whole discussion in the history of contemporary, say, philosophy and social theory, etc., which he does not, I mean, from the Frankfurt School, and even Max Weber, in a sense. I mean, this whole discussion, it's as if it does not exist. So there is a theoretical and philosophical depth of several of the issues that he discusses that he does not take at all into account. So it's quite poor. This book is very poor. I mean, independently of whether one agrees with main point that he wants to make or not, I think it's extremely poor. And yes, his inspiration from Arendt, it had very problematic.
The discussion somehow shifted totally from the psychological aspect of totalitarian mentality. And I was wondering if this author, did he ever, or, and then Hannah Arendt, I don't remember it either, you know, comparing the total submission, is the one of the major characteristic of the member of totalitarian society, submission to the government. And this is the social kind of totalitarianism. Political, if we talk about political, we're talking about the what the government does, what the state does to secure this total submission. Did they try to compare with other kind of totalitarian mentality, like religious mentality? It's a total submission to God, fundamentalist mentality. So what's the difference? Because in both cases, we have unquestionability, the final truth, the behavior, social behavior, which is comparable. So I was just wondering if the comparison to the other kind of forms of totalitarian mind can clarify, can illuminate the form of submission we have in totalitarian society. And the other question I have in totalitarian structure of mentality, for the people who experience it, are they victims or just members of certain communities or share certain views? Because obviously for me, the Soviet people were victims and not willing of the imposing of strict rules. It's not even laws, it's rules.
Thank you very much. These are very difficult questions and quite complicated. The first thing is, yes, I have focused on the political side of the issue, although Desmet's book is entitled The Psychology of Totalitarianism, because like every other concept, one has to know its content before. I mean, if you say the psychology of totalitarianism, because before developing, in a chapter, how you construe totalitarianism, then the psychology that you propose, you know, it's without referent. You understand? That's the major problem of I think it's a major problem of Desmet's book. For the question of political or social, the Arendian approach is not limited in political in the strict sense of the term, political on the sense of governmental level. She goes deep down to subjective experience, even such things. So in a sense, and even this, her use of Montesquieu points to such a gesture, because actually Montesquieu, when he says that there is not, it's not only the essence, it's the principle, which means the passions that inspire human actions in every different regime, it goes to a social level, as you said. How do people act, and how do people see each other in each regime? And for Montesquieu, in despotism, for example, there is fear. Fear is the principle of despotism. And Arendt goes a step further, maybe not exactly, because in some sense, she takes the Montesquieu's analysis of despotism, actually. But and Montesquieu says that, yes, this is here we have ideology. It's not so you understand, it's not just that when one insists on the political question, this means that one does not take into account. So and as for the second question, if they were victims, or I'm inclined to sometimes to think of this question of totalitarianism even in terms of voluntary servitude. You know, there is Claude Lefort, for example, who has written a very nice text. It's in French, Le Corps Interposé. It's on 1984 by Orwell. And there he has always written on Étienne de la Boétie's discourse on voluntary servitude. And Lefort analyzes after a moment, because he analyzes the Soviet Union since the 1940s, but after a moment toward the end of the 70s and the beginning of the 80s, he does analyze Soviet totalitarianism in terms of voluntary servitude, which would not be exactly in the, you know, in the what you said as you know, just victims. That there is also something that captures the subjects and makes them want to as La Boétie says, give themselves and everything to the master. So that, well, I would say it's not an answer, but just some thoughts.
Yeah, you know, because the discussion, major discussions after the war, and as a matter of fact, present discussions now in Russia, the social discussions and in social media and political sciences, they all concentrated on two issues, guilt and responsibility. So, and that's how we handle the possibility of formation of totalitarian regime. And what does everyone has to do to prevent it, to understand it, to not to, or otherwise we become all, you know, willing executioners. You see, if we're talking about the psychology of totalitarianism, it's both how a person becomes the member of totalitarian society and how he or she gets out of it. Jaspers and Hannah Arendt, they talk endlessly about the German guilt, endlessly, you see, and that's... The other issue is the same, you know, if we're talking about psychology of this, and it's very important.
Do we have any other comments, remarks, questions? Our next presenter is Dr. Ed Mendelowitz. He is a faculty member at the Department of Humanistic and Clinical Psychology at Saybrook University in Los Angeles, California. He also lectures at Tufts Medical Center, and by holding a license in clinical professional psychology, he sees patients in private practice. He serves on the board of directors for the Journal of Humanistic Psychology, and he's a recipient of the 2016 Rollo May Award. He's one of the world's foremost contemporary practitioners of existentially oriented psychotherapy. He has written on a variety of humanistic themes related to the arts, film, music, literature, philosophy, religion, and the broader humanities. all of which are being integrated into his psychotherapeutic approach. His presentation will be a sensitive and literary humanistic treat, reminding us that tragedy and comedy do not define, but enhance human life. When I broke the news to Ed that Matthias has changed his mind, Ed writes, quote, "If it helps, you can relay my thought to Matthias Nesmith that I find in him a distant relative. Further, as he notes, suggests, the conversation may be useful," end of quote. Here, Mendelowitz refers to an earlier remark made by Nesmith, who wrote that he was looking forward to this book discussion. It's great pleasure that I welcome Dr. Mendelowitz.
Nice to see you again. It's been some time. Thank you for those remarks. So yeah, my background is existential humanistic psychology. And my talk I call The Reinstatement of the Vague, which is a phrase out of William James, an anti-totalitarian and literary reverie. And I want to start with a quote by the Spanish philosopher José Ortega y Gasset, who writes in an essay called In Search of Goethe from Within, beautiful title. "For life is at the start a chaos in which one is lost. The individual suspects this, but he is frightened at finding himself face to face with this terrible reality. It does not worry him that his ideas are not true. He uses them as trenches for the defenses of his existence, as scarecrows to frighten away reality." I'm a fairly recent transplant to the West Coast from Boston, where I lived for many years, and that's where I met Nasir. We met through a mutual friend whose name was Eugene Teller. He passed away about 9 years ago. And he was the scholar of the so-called third force, that is to say humanistic psychology. He knew the literature better than anybody, and I think suffered for his knowledge. He was also a kind of, one mentor was Henry Murray, and I don't know if people know Murray, but he was very important, sort of precursor to humanistic psychology. And he once related this story to me that Murray told him, that Murray was lecturing at Harvard, where he spent his career. And after the lecture, a young man approached him by the name of B.F. Skinner. He was a graduate student in the class. And he said, a little derisively, he said, "If I understand you correctly, Professor Murray, what you are speaking about is a literary psychology." And Murray told the story because he kind of liked that idea. It wasn't an insult for him, but rather his idea of what psychology might be. And when Eugene told me the story, I said, "Well, that's kind of what I do." And he said to me, "That's exactly what you do." And I appreciate the story and the remark because it kind of helped me to identify myself in the field somewhat. As Arendt suggests in her essay on Benjamin, my thoughts are a commentary, perhaps more than critique. And as Helmut suggests, this is a book and an author where I find certain simpatico and overlapping interests and themes. So I mean my talk is a kind of free-spirited response of an other. Desmond uses that phrase, and others that are evocative. For me, it's a question of whether one embodies the lexicon that one uses. But as Kafka says, only in the chorus does one perceive a certain truth. So shortly after the election of Trump here in the States, I wrote an essay entitled The Angel of History, which began like this. Contemplating the painting he had purchased from the Swiss modern artist Paul Klee, Walter Benjamin wrote down these words: "A Klee painting named Angelus Novus, new angel. Shows an angel looking as though he's about to move away from something he is fixedly contemplating. His eyes are staring, his mouth is open, his wings spread. This is how one pictures the angel of history. His face is turned down toward the past, where we perceive a chain of events. He sees one single catastrophe, which keeps piling wreckage upon wreckage and hurls it in front of his feet. The angel would like to stay, awaken the dead, and make whole what has been smashed. But a storm is blowing from paradise. It has got caught in his wings with such violence that the angel can no longer close them. This storm irresistibly propels him into the future to which his back is turned, while the pile of debris before him grows skyward. This storm is what we call progress. Benjamin actually purchased this monoprint, this painting, and for him, it became a kind of object of meditation. Many of you, I think, know the painting. It's an interesting image upon which to meditate. And as you can see from his words here, there were disturbing evocations. Some years before Benjamin set down this dystopic vision, Kafka wrote in his diary, "I have been 40 years wandering from Canaan. It is indeed a kind of wandering in the wilderness in reverse. Such wandering in reverse, emblematic broadly of modernist experience and art, losing one place without gaining another, as Zadie Smith put it in an essay on Kafka, is of a piece with Clay's evocative painting, no less than Benjamin's disturbing epiphany." Benjamin, during the course of his foreshortened life, came to an understanding of Kafka as the modernist prophet who had, above all others, mapped out the spiritual territory of the modern condition. Desmet's whipping post does seem to be science, as I recall reading the book, at least by and large, whereas I see the problem as history and human anxiety for better and worse, and the storms we keep mistaking for progress. One of the other literary figures that I think of in this regard is Milan Kundera, the Czech novelist who grew up behind the Iron Curtain. And I think there was some, if I recall the story correctly, there was some thought that when he moved to the West, to Paris, that his books would change and he would become more sort of embracing of the world. And that did not happen. He continued to be just as damning, you know, as he would talk about what Milosz, his countrymen, would call the captive mind. And he writes a book of essays, I think it dates back to the late 80s, called The Art of the Novel, which I've always loved. And there is an essay in there called The Depreciated Legacy of Cervantes. I want to read just a brief passage. "As God slowly departed from the seat whence he had directed the universe and its order of values, distinguished good from evil, and endowed each thing with meaning, Don Quixote set forth from his house into a world he could no longer recognize. In the absence of the supreme judge, the world appeared in its fearsome ambiguity, the single divine truth decomposed into myriad relative truths parceled out by men. Thus was born the world of the modern era, and with it the image and model of that world. The thinking self as the basis of everything, and thus to face the universe alone, is to adopt an attitude that Hegel was right to call heroic. To take with Cervantes, the world is ambiguity, to be obliged to face not a single absolute truth, but a welter of contradictory truths embodied in imaginary selves called characters, to have as one's only certainty the wisdom of uncertainty requires no less courage." And so a Jamesian pluralism in the midst of what James would call the big looming, buzzing confusion, the vague and inarticulate, James's phrase. For James observes William Gavitt, the text is never finished. Closure is always deferred. Henry Murray is mostly remembered for the development of the thematic apperception test, a kind of projective technique that many will know. But he also became, at a certain point in his life, absolutely obsessed with Herman Melville. He moved out to the house where Melville wrote Moby Dick and lived there for some time. And the book he wrote on Melville was never, I think, completed or published. When Eugene died, I inherited some of the manuscript. That's by no means well organized, but he was obsessed with Melville. And he was especially obsessed with Melville's novel called Pierre, or The Ambiguities. This is the novel that Melville writes right after Moby Dick. And Moby Dick had a mixed reception. Melville was pressured by his publishers to make the book, I think, to change in such a way that it would sell better. I've forgotten the details here. But there was so much pressure that at a certain point, Melville just reacted and inserted something like 100 extra pages that really threw off the architecture, the aesthetic integrity of the book in a deliberate way. After this, Melville really didn't make a living as a writer. When he died many years later, people had to be reminded who he was. Herman Melville's Pierre, or The Ambiguities, is felt by many to be one of the great psychological novels of the 19th century. His protagonist searches indefatigably for a guide and way, and envies the true believer for whom faith is fixed and knowledge settled. He too seeks those, quote, indestructible anchors that bind the believer to, quote, firm faith's rock, a doctrine that can be embraced with all of one's being, such that the heart cries out at last, this is of God. And here's a passage from the text. But Pierre, where could he find the church, the Bible, the monument, which unequivocally said to him, go on, thou art in the right. I endorse thee all over. Pierre, in short, seeks the talisman secret, a thing that for a psychological genius like Melville or James can never be found, the atomized pilgrim in search of totality. As Nietzsche opines, great spirits are skeptics. One thing I can relate to in Desmond's book is his speaking to plurality. This question of to what extent he embodies this humility that hopefully might go along with that. I don't know. I'm curious to know more about the story behind his decision not to be here. But we read in James's essay, Pragmatism, profusion, not economy, might after all be reality's keynote. Art Spiegelman, whose graphic novel Mouse, you all probably know, was recently banned by the Tennessee Board of Education, once observed that the science fiction writer Philip K. Dick was the Kafka of the latter half of the 20th century. But Dick was someone who looked back as much as forward and has been placed within the Gnostic traditions by some of Christianity. His life's work he had written consisted of reveries upon two themes, the natures respectively of reality and authenticity. In an essay entitled How to Build a Universe That Doesn't Fall Apart 2 days later, the author holds his own with the most self-impressed articulators of postmodern mayhem as he laments an artificial landscape of what he calls spurious realities, while imagining longingly the arrival of fake fakes, his term, fake fakes, the great jazz musician Thelonious Monk would sometimes listen to his recordings and he'd say that was a wrong note. but here Dick is talking about fake fakes that might actually be real and thus take their stand against the charade. So this is a passage from that essay. I consider the matter of defining what is real a serious topic. And in there somewhere is the other topic, the definition of the authentic human. Because the bombardment of pseudo-realities begins to produce inauthentic humans very quickly, spurious humans, as fake as the data pressing at them from all sides. My two topics are really one. They unite at this point. Fake realities will create fake humans. Fake humans will generate fake realities and then sell them to other humans, turning them eventually into forgeries of themselves. So we wind up with fake humans inventing fake realities and then peddling them to other fake humans. It's just a very large version of Disney World. You can have the pirate ride or the Lincoln simulacrum or Mr. Toad's wild ride. You can have all of them, but none is real. At a certain point in my life, fell into the films of Federico Fellini. And I remember being in Italy at one point and coming across his final film, which was at that point completely unavailable now here in the States. It was called The Voice of the Moon. And I came home with a video copy in those days, and there were no subtitles, and I don't speak Italian, but just to see it was worthwhile for me. I recently saw it for the first time in many years, and I thought about needing to come up with something to say about this this book and this topic that we've been discussing. It stars the Italian comic Roberto Benigni, and he plays a man who is discharged from mental hospitals, and he returns to the countryside where Fellini grew up, but there's nothing tranquil about the world. He is bombarded by, you know, blaring television and commercials and loud music and beauty pageants, and even the church has become spectacle. And he says all ominous intimations of a looming subterranean fascism. Evil is obsessed by the moon and also a woman in whom he imagines a projected love object wrongly. And we hear somebody in the background say, "What am I doing here? Why was I put here in the first place?" That's the world that Fellini was seeing. You know, back in, he made this film in 91. At some point, he ends up with one shoe of the woman that he imagines that he loves. And he's at a discotheque, which is just god-awful blaring music, and presents the shoe looking for, you know, it's a play on the Cinderella story, of course. And one woman dances over to him, tries on the shoe that he's holding up, and it's a perfect fit, and he's elated. And then another woman dances up and tries the shoe. It's a perfect fit. And a third one, it's a perfect fit. And he says, "There are many of you, but you are all one." So these are the themes that I think artists have been tapping into for a very long time. I take a kind of Ronkian view of the artist type, Ronk's term, that the artist is the one that doesn't fit in. And that's why she or he or whomever produces art. The art becomes a kind of prosthetic, so to speak, that helps the person that otherwise doesn't fit a little better, at least while immersed in the artwork. Fellini used to say that as far as politics was concerned, he was more Eskimo than Italian. Lena Wertmüller, who I just realized last night when I tried to put together some final thoughts, passed away in December. And had once upon a time been his assistant director. She said about that, she said, "Fellini says that, but nobody's more political than he." And I think that's that sort of sense of paradox that is important. I'm not sure I find that in the work we're discussing today. Here's what Fellini says at a much earlier point in his life. He says, "Unmasking the lie, identifying the unauthentic, and taking apart the indefinite or false absolutes." Kafka would call it a chorus of lies, and Fellini was obsessed with Kafka for much of his life, continues to be for now the only corrective resource, a mocking, inexhaustible safeguard against our bankrupt history while we are waiting to be prepared to propose and to live under a new hypothesis of truth. Rollo May's final work was entitled The Cry for Myth. And Fellini is tapping into exactly those thoughts that we, metaphorically put, this would be Nietzsche's Death of God. Desmond closes this book with a kind of a hope of what he calls a new spring of life, which sounds on the surface of things inspired, yet for me, it's overly simplistic and likely overly optimistic as well. Rollo May used to say, pessimism, he says, I'm a realist. He says, pessimism and optimism are matters of digestion. And I personally am more inclined toward a Camusian state of perpetual vigilance in the midst of the latest and myriad gurus, narratives, and ideologies we are possibly mistaking for progress. And so I just wanted to close with the very last paragraph from The Plague, speaking of Corona. And indeed, as he listened to the cries of joy rising from the town, Rue remembered that such joy is always imperiled. He knew what those jubilant crowds did not know but could have learned from books, that the plague bacillus never dies or disappears for good, that it can lie dormant for years and years in furniture and pine chests, that abides its time in bedrooms, cellars, trunks, and bookshelves, and that perhaps the day would come when, for the bane and enlightenment of men, it would rouse up its rats again and send them forth to die in a happy city. So let me end on that cautionary note. Thank you.
Thank you, Ed. Any reflections on analogy, metaphor, associations, perhaps as they relate to our topic of Desmet?
I think associations are the right way. It's the way I think, and I hope it can amplify the discussion in some way, at least for some.
I did want to make a general comment. There is a false, and this is all my opinions, but then Ed, you can comment. There's a false, in my view, a false antagonism that is set up between science and the humanities. And this book is a good example of somebody who feels that subjectivity and human freedom and all these good things can only exist if science is destroyed. The mere existence of science contradicts that. It's the assumption that science is anti-humanistic. I think humanism is anti-humanistic when it's anti-scientific. In other words, this is consistent with Jaspers' view of all this, which is that science has its limits and it's perfectly legitimate within those limits. It's perfectly legitimate to be completely reductionistic, in fact, and objective and materialistic within those limits. Outside of those limits, it's not legitimate. That's what 19th century scientism was. The humanities are also perfectly legitimate within their limits. They have incredible insights. And I think, Ed, you're bringing out a lot of that in your discussion. I think what you're doing, Ed, is showing a way of thinking in psychology that doesn't require all the negative absolutist anti-science attitudes of the author. It doesn't, you're not saying that, but that's how I'm interpreting it, that you're pursuing this alternative. And I think it's a good way of seeing what the alternatives can be.
Yeah, I mean, I can kind of relate to many points that this guy makes, but I see it and approach it quite differently. And what you say, Nasir, is quite true.
You know, I should make a comment with regards to assuming that we need to endorse a one-view perspective on the scientific agenda, especially with regards to this topic of the COVID scenario and whatever the proposals are with regards to how one should treat it. There are many sides to that story. Now, I'm not referring to Desmet, but there are colleagues, MDs, researchers with lifelong records of accomplishments who, as they speak about a different interpretation of the facts, had to suffer severe consequences with regards to their credibility, which is actually not that much of a scientific approach that I think anyone should endorse. If there are different interpretations, there is this friendly exchange
about the differences rather than the crucification of the side that dares to speak a different point of view. I think it's important not to forget that.
Yeah, absolutely, Helmut. I appreciated the link you sent me when you invited me to join. And I did watch the abbreviated form of those. Was it the Senate hearing? Truly great spirits like James, like Jaspers, they value science, and complexity is a part of it all. You know,
one of the things that sometimes critics of science use in a way that I think is misleading is they point out correctly that scientists strongly believe their theories. You know, we say that science involves falsifying your hypotheses, and I teach this all the time. We don't falsify our hypotheses. Most clinicians and researchers and doctors, they believe what they believe. They're not going around trying to disprove what they believe. They should. That's the scientific attitude that we should have. But they don't. None of you do either. The fact is that that's human nature. People believe things. And, you know, you read Charles Peirce and the fixation of belief. Science is not about not being like being a superhuman person who doesn't believe anything and doubts everything and it's all open-minded. And actually, open-mindedness, the author of this book claims, is the nature of science. It's not at all. No human being is really open-minded. We all have beliefs. Peirce's point was that the issue is, how do you fix your belief? What's your standard for it? And his claim in that classic essay was, put aside authority, et cetera. It's experiment. And that's what science is about. It's not that I, as an individual scientist, or you as an individual scientist, or you as an MD, of course there's going to be MDs very accomplished who will have their opinions. It's not that they're actually going to be really open-minded and change their views based on the data, et cetera, et cetera. It's that over time, those who have the theories or the hypotheses that turn out to be false will be disproven. And over time, those who have the theories or the hypotheses that turn out to be true will be proven. And that's what Peirce was talking about the consensus of the scientific investigators at the limit of time. It's in a way, it's the metaphysical perspective outside of the actual life of a single scientist that shows you where the truth is. And that's also in the famous saying of the physicist Max Planck, that scientific revolutions and changes happen not by the changing of ideas, but by the changing of generations. Those scientists will hold those ideas till they die. In science, they actually can get disproven after they die, in other studies over time. And that's how you know what the truth is. So yeah, Helmut, you're going to find people with all kinds of perspectives who have MDs and PhDs after that, their name. That doesn't legitimize their perspective because they have an MD or PhD or not. What legitimizes it is actually the facts. We may debate the facts now, but in 5 years and 10 years and 100 years, we'll look back and we'll know what the facts were. We'll know what the truth was.
That's exactly the point. The problem with that, though, is that in 100 years, none of us will know which facts were turning out to be the correct ones.
Yeah, that's the tragedy of this. But like I said, 100 years ago, in the 1918 pandemic, people claimed all kinds of stuff. It's obvious to us now. But I acknowledge that other people will take different views. But I think the difference between me and the other people is that they don't agree to the same standards of truth. My standard of truth is scientific experiment, hypothesis, research, and data.
And that was exactly one of the motivations for putting together the panel, in order to have that discussion with people that make different statements about the same subject matter that turned out to be differently. The concluding presentation is by Professor Michael Schwartz, formerly clinical professor of psychiatry and professor of humanities in medicine at the Texas A&M College of Medicine in Round Rock. He is presently faculty at its Health Science Center. Dr. Schwartz is board certified in psychiatry, and he is a distinguished life fellow of the American Psychiatric Association. He's also co-founding editor of the journal Philosophy, Ethics, and Humanities in Medicine, author of nearly 200 peer-reviewed papers, book chapters, monographs, and edited volumes. He has served as founding president of the Association for the Advancement of Philosophy and Psychiatry. And since its inception, he is associate editor of the journal Philosophy, Psychiatry, Psychology.
His expertise includes person and people-centered approaches to psychiatric assessment, care, treatment, which for our panel today adds a valuable perspective with regards to claims about crowd or mass formation. Dr. Schwartz, thank you for being here.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I'm going to, because the whole presentation has been so wonderful, I'm going to make a few changes in discussing this bold and ambitious volume, The Psychology of Totalitarianism, which when it's published in June, I think really will create quite a stir and something we should be aware of. The fundamental problem is our faith and willingness to continue to participate in public health, which is not very person-centered. And to a certain degree, the challenge here of this new virus, there's a certain amount of making it up as we go along, and that's just the way it is. I'm going to start with just a brief story, truth. I mentioned this earlier. Tony Fauci, who is running the national initiative, is not someone I know because I haven't seen him in 50 years, but he was one of my most powerful teachers when I was starting out my career in medicine at Cornell in the 1970s. I was a young guy. I was 20 years old when I got my MD. I was an intern. I wasn't sure whether I was really a doctor or playing doctor. I was doing my best. One thing we did back then, we interns were assigned the job of starting the intravenous lines when they ran out. There were no nurses, there was no staff. You would be on call that night and you'd be called at 3-4 o'clock in the morning to restart someone's intravenous line. So we did this to a lot of patients we didn't know. And what we would do to prevent being awakened in the middle of the night were called IV rounds. We'd go around late at night, checking on the rooms to make sure the intravenous lines were working and then go to sleep. One of my most powerful, important and teachers and professors had been admitted earlier in the day to the hospital. He was very distinguished. I didn't quite know him at all personally, not even very well, but he had some kind of something in his throat. I didn't know that. I go into his room at midnight. It's a big private room in the hospital, and the light is shining through the window and the moon is coming in. And I see the man lying in bed with his arms out and his legs out. He had cut every artery in his arms, neck, and legs. He was in the process of committing suicide. And I took a look at him. He took a look at me and he said, "Leave, just go. No one will know you were here. What would you do? You're a kid. Being a doctor is something you don't even really identify with yet. And this happens." What I did was I panicked, and of course I called for help. And we saved his life. And later on, it turned out the story was that he actually had a terrible case of a terminal cancer. And he had thoughtfully admitted himself to the hospital with the goal of killing himself at night when there was no one in the room. He didn't expect me to show up, and I did. So that was a very forming experience for me as a young doctor. And I'm mentioning this today because the person I discussed this with at length was a guy a few years older than me, who's now 81 years old, by the name of Anthony Fauci. And he really helped me understand what I did, what I knew, what I didn't know, how to act. I was unprepared for this. He had not talked about his problems. Of course, how could he? This certainly made me a doctor. This was the experience that made me realize this is not a game. This is life and death. You have people's lives in your hands, and this is what you do. So Tony Fauci is one of the formative people in my life as a physician. I haven't known him in 50 years, and I just became reacquainted with him through the literature with what he's doing now. But public health has that quality. There is a quality of making it up as we go along. We don't know what we should know. And criticism is really very easy because things turn out differently and we do our best and we move along and it's part of our humanity. But I will say that faith in public health is essential despite the fact that errors are made. The importance of vaccination and going with the program is important, and there's got to be room for criticism. But to polarize this into the way it is polarized now, I think is really shameful, frankly. I was disappointed in reading the book because I think the notion of mass formation has some validity. We are influenced by media. We are influenced by multi-billion dollar corporations. There is capitalism involved, but it's not that simple. And I think that the author of the book is taking one side of a case to make his own case, and that's kind of a shame. Okay, the other point I wanted to make, the general point I wanted to make, is the loving struggle that we talked about earlier, the dialogue, is wonderfully illustrated in the letters that Hannah Arendt and Karl Jaspers wrote to each other from 1926, when she was a student of his, to his death in 1969. And they really do represent a loving struggle because they took very different points of view on a whole variety of topics. And if you read the letters, you'll see how she really influenced his opinion in many ways, maybe even more so than vice versa. I also, when I was a young doctor, was working at a hospital in Manhattan and decided to go to the New School to study philosophy, et cetera. Sadly, Hannah Arendt was elderly at the point, or ill, I should say. But my colleague Osborne Wiggins had spent a lot of time with her. So I got a lot of exposure both to Jaspers, his point of view, and Arendt. When Jaspers died, at his funeral, Arendt wrote that he was a man who realizes human existence in an exemplary way and is the bodily incarnation of something we would otherwise know only as a concept or ideal. Now, back to the book, the idea that totalitarian in our life nowadays is not caused by dictators or whatever, but it's a kind of a group thing controlled by big media, the state, business, et cetera. That's a theme that probably is worth pursuing. And I think it's kind of sad that this has gotten so polarized and focused on a particular view of undermining the vaccine and undermining our strong faith in science and scientific research. Okay, so a lot of what Desmond does in the book is he has a discussion of how this has gone on and on and on since 9/11 and the new bureaucracy, the new technocrats are leading this totalitarianism, no longer people like Hitler and Stalin. And there is much to be skeptical about. And I will quote Hannah Arendt: the ideal subject of totalitarian rule is not the convinced Nazi or convinced communist, but people for whom the distinction between fact and fiction and the distinction between true and false no longer exist. So what do you do when something like COVID occurs, something which is absolutely unfathomable? We don't quite know what's going on or what to do. How do we arrange public health? And how do we have the guts to be leaders like Dr. Fauci and make this thing work to the best of our abilities? There is no doubt that we will suffer for decades because we're putting masks on young children. They're not learning how to communicate with each other. As a psychiatrist, we already see problems from the lack of human socialization. Even this internet socialization can be criticized as compared to really being in the same room with each other. It's a trend now in psychiatry to have sessions like this, and so much is missed because we're not bodily together. But what do we do about this rather than have a political fight? There is no doubt that there is clear value for humanity of vaccines. And again, starting with the eradication of smallpox in the US in 1972, worldwide 10 years later, tetanus, diphtheria, measles, mumps, chickenpox, pneumococcal pneumonia, whooping cough, all of these were eliminated by vaccines. You can't say that 85% of the research is nonsense. This is really true. This is not a matter of ideology. This is a matter of the fact that the average age that people lived to 150 years ago was 40,
and now it's a lot longer. The other problem is, I was going to make a point about psychosis. The notion that mass, that there's this mass formation psychosis. I'm glad Desmond did not go all the way and buy into that, because by definition, a psychosis involving a delusion is idiosyncratic. You can't have a social psychosis. Calling my political enemies psychotic is just terrible. A psychosis is my personal belief. It's idiosyncratic. Nobody really understands it except me. It's incorrigible. There would be no point in having this discussion because I'm not going to ever change my mind. And it's perseverative. It's always on my mind, always on my mind, always on my mind. That clearly does not define the phenomena that is being discussed in the book. And I'm glad that term was not used. But I also think that there's another important distinction that I'd like to just raise, because it just hasn't been raised so far today. That's the distinction between understanding and explanation, between Verstehen and Erklärung. That's where mathematics comes into play. And yes, at the highest level of quantum physics, we can question the precision of mathematics, et cetera. But mathematical, 2 and 2 is 4. For all practical purposes in the world in which we live. And the fact that this particular president is an idiot and this one is wonderful, that's going to be a matter of opinion. We might not have the discussion honestly or openly because it's impolite, but there's always another way to look at things. Understanding is not explanation. And this notion of mass formation is an interesting form of understanding. It's a way of understanding how we are manipulated. And I think it's kind of a shame that it's kind of become explanation, because that shuts off discussion. On the one hand, we have the author criticizing the mathematics of science. On the other hand, he's giving us clear logical answers, just what he criticized in the first place. You can't have it both ways.
I really appreciate your rap, Michael. And I'm just reminded that Rollo May used to always say, you know, you write books with questions, not answers. And Kundera, in that essay that I read a brief passage from, the name of the essay was The Depreciated Legacy of Cervantes. And he says the same thing, that this is what the novel does. It poses questions.
I think that if that were the theme of the author, these would be questions that we might really ask about. How do we get these ideas? Should public health be as required as it is, or is it an infringement on our liberty? Of course it's an infringement on our liberty. But as I said, look at the incredible benefits. Will there be disadvantages? Yes. How do we catch them? How do we change them without fighting with each other? That's the issue.
It's kind of a slightly academic point. And I know you know this literature very well. The term mass quote-unquote formation has no meaning. It hasn't been discussed in the psychiatric or psychological literature at all before the Joe Rogan podcast. Am I right about that? Is that your knowledge of it as well?
Yeah, I would say that, but it's kind of an intuitive thing that we all come together with this.
Is that what formation means?
I think
it's some pretty bad English. I mean,
yeah.
Why not just say mass psychology? I mean, that's, if you say mass psychology, without, that's a neutral term. It doesn't imply what you're doing, but it's about what people are like when they're in masses or in large groups. Then you can start with Laban, like this guy does. But then you got Freud, you got Bion, you have Ortega y Gasset, who had mentioned, wrote a famous book in 1930, around 1930, called The Masked Man. So there's plenty of literature to talk about. And it's very relevant, as you said. There's a lot in there about conformism and about how the average, for instance, my view is the average normal human being conforms to the social larger group. That's a wealthy discussion. That's a wealth of topics we can discuss. But it's not psychosis, like you said. It's not hysteria.
Yeah.
It's not formation, whatever that means. I think those phrases are not helpful. But I think there's a lot larger literature on mass and group psychology that is important.
I'm just thinking of Freud and Jung and Adler and coming up with a new term. I have a friend who actually buys in now to the idea that this is a conspiracy to control all of us. And he will make the point, Why do people stand on long lines to get vaccinations? Why do I have to wear this mask? Look at the damage the mask is doing, and on and on and on and on and on. And these are not crazy ideas, but if they undermine the notion of vaccination, if they undermine the notion of public health, that would be terrible.
I like, Michael, how you really make it clear, you know, that what psychosis actually is in clinical psychiatry, and that people use it very loosely. There is a way out, perhaps. I never really heard anyone talk about it that much, that is used Wernicke's concept of overvalued ideas, because that is something where you can think about a mass phenomenon. And it really has this idea that it's not psychosis, but it is something where people pursue certain ideas at a level that makes no sense anymore, where they harm themselves. So I would say that for many people, if they truly thought about vaccine or not without the social context, they would probably not think twice. For them, it becomes an overvalued idea and an identity that they cannot give up, harming themselves, their families, and their communities as part of this. This is something that Wernicke has really thought very hard about, and that is, I feel, is really ignored because it is this interface between sociology and clinical psychiatry, which is, I think, what we're actually talking about.
I agree. Actually, in my presentation, I was going to talk about overvalued idea as a softer way of talking about this distinction. But the overvalued idea is supposed to cause harm. And the problem is, if you have the overvalued idea, you think the conventional is causing harm. And how can we have the kinds of discussions that Hannah Arendt and Carl Jaspers had over the years? They really, in many ways, had a loving relationship, like a parent to a daughter. Amazing how gentle they were with each other, but they really disagreed very strongly. How can we have that kind of a discussion? How do we deal with the damage that is done by masks for children? How do we deal with the rules of public health, which sometimes will be arbitrary? How do we buy into that? I think it's actually very sad that we can't have an honest, respectful discussion about these things without this kind of accusation. I was very disappointed in the tone of the book, because some of the things he said were just completely, wow, why is he doing that? It's kind of building an audience.
One aspect that helps to keep focus on the accuracy of the debate, from my understanding, it is not that one side of that argument says vaccinations are bad. I think there is a qualification for this particular one with regards to a change approach in the production of it, where it is no longer a dead virus vaccination, but a genetically modified version of it, and which brings suspicion in, you know, some people's minds. If we have the discussion with regards to vaccine, it's not a generalized opposition against vaccinations as such, but more a specific concern with regards to the presumption that it is not sufficiently tested in preclinical environment.
Another point I wanted to make was that Desmond makes the comment, we witnessed the abrupt pivot of nearly every country on earth to follow China's example and place huge populations of people under de facto house arrest. I don't think we're doing that in this culture, but they certainly did that in China. And they did that again when there was another variant of the virus. And one of the most interesting things I've heard is the idea that now China has the perfect weapon against the West. Invent a new virus, spread it out there in the world. We can control it in China because we'll put people in their homes and it will kill everybody in these other countries. Now that's a crazy idea too, but I've actually heard that. You see what I'm saying? Our freedom in a way can undermine our safety. A really totalitarian and authoritarian society can control a virus like this better than ours will ever be able to. You kind of have to grow up a little bit.
There certainly are variations of perspective that can be taken. For instance, as Helmut points out, you know, the public health measures taken in China, or maybe that were taken early on in the pandemic, weren't the only ones that could be taken. And in Sweden, as everyone knows, you know, they took a much more open approach with some worsened outcomes, but you could argue, although it's at least these get into some difficult ethical discussions. Is it okay for some thousands of elderly people to die, for children to be able to go to school? You're comparing apples and oranges. this gets into ethical discussions. These are not purely scientific decisions anymore. And certainly there are going to be different differences of perspective there, even now. And you know, nobody is talking about mandating masks, even though we know we have a surge going on. And 2 years ago, they would have mandated masks. So even now in our country, things have changed. So I think these are the legitimate points of difference that could generate meaningful discussion, as long as everyone agrees at some level on some basic foundational things. For instance, that science is legitimate and it's not a complete fraud. That's, I think, where we have a problem here.
I think there is a tendency to slide from denying that science is illegitimate, which I think is an obvious truth. So we don't want to affirm that science is illegitimate, but then we don't want to take that to be the license for an uncritical faith in science, right? Maybe most people and most scientists believe the things that they believe, and that's fine, but that doesn't mean the things that they believe in virtue of their training and so are true. And the history of science doesn't really bear that out. So there has to be space for looking at what the evidence provided by science is in a critical way, and being willing, as it were, to take initially evidence at face value, but also being willing to criticize that without denying that science is a legitimate endeavor.
So Pierre, science as a profession has been doing that for 100 years. What you're describing is a straw man that hasn't existed since 1900.
You slide actually from the claim that in the past, in the 19th century, scientism was a bad thing, to the claim that the scientism that applies to the 19th century was a bad thing. But now it's good to be scientistic.
Not at all. Not at all.
That.
Not at all. I don't say scientific. I'm saying be scientific within limits. That's not scientistic.
What are the limits that you place on science?
Basically, the same critiques that most of the philosophers of science have made in the 20th century. Science does not give you absolute truths. Science gives you probabilistic truths. It can be wrong. In fact, truth is corrected error in Peirce's view.
Then you appeal to these examples to make your case, where it's assumed by you that the truths that you're claiming are absolute.
No, I do. I never said the word absolute. Probabilistic at 95% certainty is much better than choosing the 5%. That's all I'm saying.
And even when that's the case, Nasir, I think you had a really great example. What if the virus of the future is something that kids will just get sick with, big deal, miss a few days of school, and then get immunity, but it's going to kill most people over 80? What do we do as a society? But if we put the kids in masks and keep them socially distanced, we're going to have massive psychological and social problems in the years to come. How do we figure that out? How do we even begin to have a discussion about that if we're going to get angry at each other and blame each other for misinterpreting the facts? I think this is the question. This ambiguity is going to be at the core of so much that we do.
And this fear of science, this unwillingness to accept scientific truth. I mean, like just in this discussion, like the belief that if someone defends science, they must be an absolutist about it. It's just another example of this problem. We need to be, more flexible than that. I think if push comes to shove, most of us would agree that, because it's hard to defend it intellectually, that extreme postmodern relativism where you reject science is wrong, and extreme absolutism about science as if it's a new religion is wrong. Let's all accept that and then try to work in the middle, because these are very difficult dilemmas where if there's not some foundational agreement, you can't get at then these questions that are beyond science, these ethical ones, like what you just brought up, Michael. The public health decision-making that really goes beyond science per se, but becomes then a matter of social judgment, cultural preferences, etc.
This is a good point to close with the open questions that we recognize and realize are as far as we can go. And with a truthful and courageous continuation of the dialogue, we will find good and not so good answers in order to deal with these problems that we are still about to face. Thank you very much, everyone, for participating, for joining the panel. It was a very well-rounded event. We managed to have harsh points and soft points. Thank you all very much, and stay in contact.